Well, I am Pastor Carl, and I'm honored and excited to have this opportunity to share with you folks this morning. Now, last week, our minister intern explored the appearance of Jesus to Thomas. Now, Thomas doubted, and we will doubt too, and doubting is okay as long as we do so with looking toward Jesus. And today, we're focusing on Jesus' appearance to Peter. But first, some of you may have seen my Facebook Live video or my Instagram Live video yesterday, and if you did, you know I talked about these two celebrities in particular. Now, some of you may know these familiar faces. The gentleman on the left is Robert Downey Jr. Some of you may know him as Tony Stark. There's like silence here. Some heads nodding. Okay. The gentleman on the right is Justin Bieber. Some of you may know him as the young YouTube prodigy superstar gone wild. Now, here are their pics after they made bad decisions. These are actually their mugshots. Now, Robert Downey Jr. on the left, he's an A-list celebrity who is currently at the top of his game. He starred in one of the most successful franchises in movie history. But in 1996, he struggled with drug addiction. He was arrested, and he even spent a year in jail. And in 2000, he was arrested again, and he served 3 years probation. Now, Justin Bieber on the right, I don't know why he's smiling in that picture. It's like he's happy to be arrested. He was a child prodigy who was discovered on YouTube, and he became an instant sensation. His music was spread worldwide, but perhaps it was too much fame for a child to bear, and he began making wrong choices and eventually got into trouble with the law on numerous occasions. Now, many news sources began to report on every single mistake that Justin made. Well, fast forward to today, he has a tight relationship with a pastor from Hillsong Church in Australia, and he claims to be a Christian, and though many are skeptical, that is what he claims. Well, for me, I must say that I am a fan of Robert Downey Jr., and I'm man enough to admit that I am a fan of Justin Bieber, but I am a bigger fan of redemption, of reconciliation, of restoration. And both of these men made bad choices in life, choices that had terrible consequences, yet they both have been restored in some sense to their former selves. And so, if you're a fan of redemption and restoration stories, then you will enjoy the case study we will focus on today. In fact, today's message is entitled Restored. And we will look at Jesus' interaction with Peter after Jesus was crucified and then resurrected. Now, before we jump into our scripture, I want to spend some extensive time introducing and perhaps reintroducing you to Peter. All right? So, remember, he was one of the 12 disciples of Jesus, and he was in Jesus' inner circle. Remember, Jesus spent most of his time with three of the 12 disciples, right? John, James, and Jingleheimer Smith, right? No, I'm just playing. John, James, and Peter. And Peter was a fisherman. That was his profession. That's what he did. And Peter was called to follow Jesus while he was fishing with his brother Andrew on the Sea of Galilee. And Jesus told Simon Peter and Andrew, in Matthew we can see this, "Come follow me, and I will send you out to fish for people." And at once they left their nets and they followed him. Now also, Peter's name was actually Simon, but Jesus gave Simon the name Peter. In Matthew 16 we can read, "And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it." Now in Greek, Peter is Petros, which means rock. So Peter was a very key disciple, and Jesus was preparing Peter to be a significant leader in spreading the news about Jesus, and Peter would become one of the forerunners in establishing the early church after Jesus' death and resurrection. And one of the most memorable moments in Peter's life is when Jesus predicted that he would deny Jesus three times. In John 13, Simon Peter asked him, "Lord, where are you going?" Jesus replied, "Where I am going, you cannot follow, but will follow later." Peter asks, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I will lay down my life for you. Then Jesus answered, will you? Will you really lay down your life for me? Very truly I tell you, before the rooster crows, you will disown me three times. Well, eventually, Jesus is arrested and is put on trial. And check out what Peter does when his opponents, the opponents of Jesus, recognize Peter.
Many heard you say you would destroy the temple and in 3 days build another. Some testified here before the Sanhedrin that you said this. How do you respond? Are you going to refuse to answer? Are you, or are you not, the Messiah?
I am. And soon you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of God.
How dare you speak his name? The charge is blasphemy. He deserves to die.
Man.
No.
Is you?
Oh, no.
This man is one of the Nazarene's men.
I don't know him. You're mistaken.
This man walks with this Son of God.
I do not. I don't know him. I've never seen him before.
Take him away.
That clip is from AD, the Bible series, which is a powerful TV show that aired a few years ago. But do you see the emotion that Peter felt in this clip? The feeling that he disappointed Jesus. The feeling that he completely let Jesus down, which in turn, we'll find out, caused Peter to shut down. Well, this clip sets up our section of scripture for the day. Our main scripture comes from the book of John. You can follow in your Bibles, or we'll put it on the screen. But this is from John chapter 21, and we're going to start in verse 15. Jesus reinstates Peter. So verse 15. When they had finished eating, Jesus said to Simon Peter, Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these? Yes, Lord, he said. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my lambs. Again, Jesus said, Simon, son of John, do you love me? He answered, yes, Lord, you know that I love you. And Jesus said, take care of my sheep. The third time he said to him, Simon, son of John, do you love me? Peter was hurt because Jesus asked him the third time, do you love me? He said, Lord, you know all things. You know that I love you. And Jesus said, feed my sheep. Very truly I tell you, when you were younger, you dressed yourself and went where you wanted. But when you are old, you will stretch out your hands and someone else will dress you and lead you where you do not want to go. And Jesus said this to indicate the kind of death by which Peter would glorify God. Then he said to him, follow me. May God bless the reading of his word this morning. Now, not long after Peter denied Jesus, chaos and confusion ensued. The disciples were in a state of panic, and so they scattered and fled out of fear. But a few of them regrouped. Peter and some of the disciples went back to the Sea of Galilee, the same exact place where Jesus first called him to be fishers of men. That's where they went. And Peter told the other disciples that he wanted to go fishing. And so the other disciples accompanied him on the boat. Now, why did Peter want to go fishing after Jesus died? Well, there's a few theories. Maybe Peter was hungry, or could it be he wanted to clear his mind? I know sometimes like I like to play basketball and tennis to clear my mind, and fishing. It's a good way to clear your mind. It gives you time to think and process what's going on in life. Or perhaps Peter wanted to return to what was familiar to him, fishing. Well, whatever the reason, this is where we find some of the disciples in the next clip. Check this out.
How long do we bring in the nets?
Not yet.
Wouldn't any fish likely to have swum into the net during the night have done so by now?
They're more active at dawn.
Dawn's over?
I tell you how to collect taxes.
No.
And don't tell me about collecting fish.
But do you not
think... Another word. You're going over the side.
I'll help.
And me.
I don't understand it. Sea's usually boiling with fish this time of year.
We need to throw back the few that we have caught.
Perhaps if we brought the nets in when I said...
Please, shut up!
Your catch?
Poor!
Cast your nets on the right-hand side.
Left or right, it won't make any difference.
Cast them on the right-hand side.
Peter!
It's him.
Peter!
You told me I would deny you three times. I thought it impossible. I thought you don't know me at all.
But you knew me better than I know myself.
Peter, do you love me?
You know I love you.
Feed my lambs. Do you truly love me?
You know I do.
Feed my sheep. Peter, do you love me?
I love you.
Then follow me.
You know, this thing about them not recognizing Jesus, it makes me think about this one time that I came home from seminary. I went to seminary in California, and one of the church members, I'm not going to say who it was, they saw me, and they said, "Carl, I almost didn't recognize you because you came some fat, yeah?" And you know there's emphasis when there's like the pause, right? Some fat, yeah. I was like, whoa, whoo. Didn't have to pause that long. By the way, an update on my weight, because I know some of you have been asking, and a few years ago, I told you folks I wanted to lose weight, because I stepped on the scale, 206 plus pounds, right? And I was like, man, I got to do something about this. Well, last week, I weighed myself, and I'm the lightest I've been in over 6 years. So I feel really good about that. Wanted to give you an update on that. Anyways, Peter and the disciples, they didn't recognize Jesus because of his weight. It wasn't that, right? They didn't recognize Jesus because Jesus was far away. But after they threw their nets on the other side of the boat, which, by the way, sounded ludicrous, right? What does it matter what side of the boat? They realized that their Savior had not only come back to life, but their Savior, Jesus Christ, was standing there on the shore. Now, I know that there was a lot of setup for our scripture today, and we spent a lot of time on context of these verses, but it is essential to highlight the context so that we may understand the significance of Jesus restoring Peter. So, Peter denies Jesus 3 times. It was his test to stand up for Jesus, yet under all the pressure, he chose to deny Christ. In fact, amidst all the chaos, Peter chose to run away from Jesus and abandon everything that his master had taught him for the past 3 years. Imagine how Peter felt. Have you been there? Have you ever done something that you regret? Something that caused you to beat yourself up over and over? Are you still in that place today? Is that you today? Well, there are a few routes that we can take when applying these verses to our lives. And today, I want us to consider 3 things that we can learn from Peter's restoration. All right, so number one, 3 points here. Number one, God knew you would fail. He knew you would fail. Remember, Jesus knew every single time that you would fail. Every single time you would fail in life, every time you would fail to accomplish his mission, and every single time you would fail to follow him. And there's peace in knowing that God knows all. When Jesus asked Peter, "Do you love me?" Peter answered, "Yes, I love you." But Jesus knew what the answer was before asking the question. It goes beyond that too. Jesus knew that Peter would deny him 3 times, and we can take comfort in remembering that Jesus knows all. In the Old Testament, the psalmist David writes, "You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You discern my going out and my, or you perceive my thoughts from afar. You discern my going out and my lying down. You are familiar with all my ways. And before a word is on my tongue, you, Lord, know it completely." It's Psalm 139. So what's the big deal? How does that apply to us? Well, if Jesus knows everything about me, then there is nothing that we can hide from him. Folks, check out this picture. If you're asking, yes, that's an inflatable Santa peeping into a window. Santa may see you when you are sleeping. He may know when you're awake. But God knows more than that. He knew every single time that you would fail. Yet, he chose to die for you. Knowing every single time you would fail, he still chose to die for you. And there's freedom in that thought. Because no matter what the circumstances, no matter how bad your failures or your bad decisions were, Jesus still chose to die for you. So no matter how we may be denying Jesus in our lives, he still died. So don't dwell in your failure to follow Jesus. Don't dwell in your mistakes and bad choices. In this life, you will fail. And when you do, don't try to hide from Jesus, because newsflash, he already knows. He knows all about you, your mess-ups, your mistakes. He knows every time that you have and will ever deny him. Peter had no clue that he would deny Jesus, much less deny Jesus 3 times. But Jesus knew and called Peter to move forward from his failure. And when Jesus appeared to Peter, he found him dwelling in his mistake, in his failure. But in restoring Peter, Jesus encouraged him to move on from his failure. Okay, so point number one, God knew you would fail. Our second point, Give your failures to God. Give your failures to God. Peter must have felt awful talking to the resurrected Christ. He must have felt shame. But in conversing with Jesus, Peter did not feel beaten up. Peter felt restored. So I want to say this. Part of accepting the forgiveness of Christ is when you actively forgive yourself. When you mess up, make a mistake, or deny Christ, it's essential not to continue that behavior. So make sure to seek wise counsel, change your lifestyle, fill your mind with the truths that we get from the Bible. But don't forget to forgive yourself when you mess up. That's part of giving your failures to God. Don't avoid God. Talk to him when you fail, just as Peter talked to Jesus. A pastor from Passion City Church said, "Let us not relive our pain, but let Jesus relieve it." Let us not relive our pain, but let Jesus relieve our pain. Now, I'll be the first to admit that there are many times in life that I have trouble letting go. I keep wondering why the same depressing thoughts come to my mind. I relive my pain over and over. But we must realize that it's not enough to make like Elsa and just let it go. It's not enough. Because when we let go, what tends to happen is that our thoughts come back, right? We let go and it comes back, and we tend to fail the same way. We relive the pain of the past, and in that way, our past tends to haunt us. Most of the time, letting go implies avoiding and trying to forget our mistakes and failures. But God doesn't want you to let go. He wants you to give your failures to him, right? He doesn't want you to let go. He wants you to give it to him. Let me illustrate this point for you. It's like a yo-yo, right? You know what a yo-yo is. When you play with a yo-yo, you let it go. And then what happens? What happens when you let it go? Right. It comes back. And the process repeats over and over. You let it go, and it comes right back. Let it go, then it comes back again. Now, one way to stop the process with the yo-yo of it coming back is you make a mistake, right? That's me. But another way to stop this repetitive process is to take the string off your finger. Well, I think that's Jesus. That's what he wants you to do. He wants you to take the string off your finger and give the string to him. Stop letting go of the yo-yo and give God the string. When we don't give our failures to God, it's like we're saying that the cross wasn't good enough, right? When we don't go to God, it's like, Jesus, that was pretty remarkable what you did on the cross, but it wasn't enough for me. So give God the string. Now, we may have reasons we want to avoid giving God the string. Perhaps it's fear or pride or confusion. But to stop the yo-yo of failure from coming back again and again in your life, you must give God the string. So what's your yo-yo? What's your string? What do you need to give God today? All right, our final thought to focus on. Number 3, look to the future. Look to the future. This means moving beyond our past failures and mistakes and looking to the future. That's what Jesus did with Peter. When Jesus said, "Peter, do you love me? Then feed my sheep." What Jesus was doing for Peter was painting a picture of the future. It's almost like telling Peter, hey, I know you made a mistake. You denied me, but it's okay. You love me. And this is what I want you to do. Do you love me? Then move on. Hey, Peter, do you love me? Then come on, let's move on. This is what I have for you. Jesus is showing Peter God's will for his life beyond his failure. Now, part of looking to the future is not letting the past weigh you down. It's really important. There's a pastor from Saddleback Church, Rick Warren. He says, "We are all a product of our past, but we don't have to be prisoners of our past, right? We're all a product of our past, but we don't have to be prisoners. Check this picture out. Some of you may know this location. Anybody out loud? Alcatraz, correct. This is Alcatraz. It's an island that has one of the most famous prisons in the world. Now, what made this prison famous was the story about the inmates that escaped. Now, I've been to this prison, Lauren and I, we took a tour, and it's an incredible sight, one of the best tours I've ever taken. It's a self-guided tour, so it's really cool. And here's actually a picture of the cell. Those are two cells, actually, right? So they're really narrow. The Alcatraz cell each contained one inmate, and most prisoners could actually extend their arms and touch the walls of their cell. It was really tiny, like a little over 5 feet wide, and I think 10 feet long. But do you know how those prisoners escaped? They used tools to carve out a hole in the stone wall. And it took them months to get the hole large enough for their bodies to fit through. One of the tools that they used, one of the main tools that they used, was a spoon. This spoon right here. No, I'm just playing. A spoon. Eventually, they escaped at night, and we have no idea what happened to them. And some think they drowned in the cold waters of the bay. Others think they swam to safety. But I think this is a lot like our lives, right? Our past has a tendency to imprison us. And we think we can just go around the wall that's stopping us from being free of our past. There's a wall in the way, and we think we can go around or under or over it. But just like the Alcatraz story, I think we have to go through. We have to go through our past to be free from it. It's going to take work to get through the wall that stands in the way of freedom. But the good news is that God gives us a spoon. It may not seem like much, but it is enough to get us through the wall. Not around it, through. It took the prisoners months to dig. And it will take you time as well. Months, maybe years to dig. I know I'm digging right now through some things, and you probably are too. But don't forget that Jesus can only heal what you reveal, right? Jesus can heal you, but you have to do the work to reveal what he's going to heal. And he wants to heal you from your past so you may accomplish what he has planned for you in the future. There is a future for you beyond your past failures. And this future can mean freedom. Jesus painted a picture for Peter, a picture of what his future would look like. And Jesus freed Peter from his past and restored him to the point where Peter could see God's plan to build the church to the point where it still exists today. And that's what God's plan was for Peter. And God has a plan for you too. Peter felt the guilt of denying Jesus, the shame of seeing him face to face afterwards. He felt the constraining feeling of failure. But with the help of Jesus restoring him, he broke through the wall of failure and it freed him from that prison. So what wall of failure is stopping you from being free? How can you begin to the process of grabbing a spoon from God and putting in the work, digging into that wall so you may go through it? What is God calling you to do in this season that you are in? Folks, failure is inevitable, but God knew you would fail, and he wants you to give it to him so that you may look to the future and follow his plans for your life. I'm going to ask the musicians to come up as I close with a few thoughts. God restored Peter, and he wants to restore you. God is looking beyond conviction, and he is looking to carry you through whatever it is you're going through or have been through. So have you been denying God in some sense? That's you. Take hold of the fact that God is not looking to blame you for your denial, but rather bring you back. Jesus wants to bring you from shame to secure. And maybe today you are running from Jesus. Maybe that's you. We all go through that in our lives, times where we run away from God. But if that's you, if you're running from Jesus, the good news is that you can be restored by Jesus if you would just change direction and run toward Him. Not away from Him, but toward Him. Let's pray together. God, thank you so much for the record we have of Simon Peter, a man who denied you only to be restored by the risen Christ. Thank you for how you show us how amazing your love is. Thank you for forgiveness. And pray that you'll give us the strength to give our failures to you. Also, give us the courage to forgive ourselves. I pray for those who may be running from God, whatever the reason. I pray that they will be willing to be restored by you, whether it's sin or pride or doubt. God, would you just comfort and encourage them right now? And please, God, reveal to us your plan for our lives. Help us to see beyond the past. Help us to look forward to the future. And then give us the courage to follow your plan for our lives with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength because of our love for you. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.